Hello children, how are you all? I welcome you back to our new virtual learning session. Today, we are going to deal with social science. And in social science, we are going to see the branch of economics. In economics, chapter number 2. But before sliding ahead, let us have a general discussion about why human as a social animal is very essential on this earth. Why human is given much importance as a social animal regarding all other animals. The only reason man can understand things scientifically. Even animals do understand. They have their different qualities, different visions, but man is one step ahead of them. Today, in this chapter, we will study in detail about man. Even if he is having a common aspect called brain, how it is being utilized on various aspects of our life. If the situation matters, if the problem matters, if your courage matters, whatever decision it is, at last it is going to give the shape to your goals, to your plans that is to be executed, children. Clear? So let us slide ahead to know our chapter's name. So our second slide reveals us our chapter's second name, People as a Resource. How and why people can be used as resources. In our last chapter, The Story of Village Palampur, we did study how people add to the one of the major capital, that is the human capital, for the product to give its output. The product cannot take the shape or birth by itself. It has to be designed and put on accordingly and strategically to achieve the end product. So there, people, because the physical form has to be there for the execution of plan and the end product of the plan to be achieved. Now in this chapter, we will deal with why people as a resource are very important to deal with the societal changes and the attributions people look ahead, their view, they look ahead in their respective lives. Let us slide ahead. Starting with the overview of the chapter, children. Overview will give us the clear conceptual knowledge of the topic, People as a Resource. The chapter, People as a Resource, is an effort to explain population as an asset for the economy rather than a liability. Over here, the word population means the entire population of our country. One should see the population as an asset, as an investment, rather than a liability, rather than a responsibility. For example, if you are investing in gold, if you are purchasing gold, that is your asset, because we all know that the rate of gold is clearly going to increase in the coming days. So that will be an example of asset. Likewise, this definition states that people should be seen as an asset rather than a liability, because when you invest in people, definitely they are going to grow up into a more mature citizen of that country, and they will pay back by giving
their skills to our own country, and that leads to the growth of the country. The financial growth, the economic growth is been seen, while human is been seen as an asset rather than a liability. Liability is just responsibility. You are not worried about the outcome. See, as gold, as an example, as an asset, you are very sure that it is going to give you back good returns. Clear? But when you are assigned with some work, just as a responsibility, just we have to complete that work, just for namesake we are completing, that's it. We are not bothered about the outcomes. Clear? That is known as liability. Population becomes human capital. Population, all skilled, unskilled, educated, uneducated, everyone. Population becomes human capital when there is investment made in the form of education, training, and medical care. Clear? Population consists of all types of people, but when they are changed to human capital, only when they are productive, they will be counted as human capital. Only when they are, you know, trained to give the desired outputs for any organization they are working for, they will be known as human capital. So population becomes human capital when there is investment made in the form of education. If a child is well educated from his lowest standard till his higher education, of course he is going to be a resource to the rich human capital. And training and medical care, these are the subjects that has been related while we are getting education. We know about the hygiene, we know about being in clean state, so your mind is well educated. In fact, human capital is the stock of skill. We just now discussed, only when your skill is productive to some organization, you will be identified through your skills. So human capital is the stock of skill and productive knowledge. Your skill should give shape to the product you are working upon. For example, if you are a automobile engineer, you have the skills to design the car. So your skill is your brain knowledge. Yes, productive knowledge, when you put that actual design on the particular car. So both of this goes hand in hand, your skill and your productive knowledge embodied in them, going hand to hand. People as resource is a way of referring to a country's working people in terms of their existing productive skills and abilities. So education plays a very major role in for a country for becoming much and much efficient in itself, rather on depending on other countries. So only when people are seen as an asset, as a resource, this all things will come into existence. So people as a resource is a way of referring to a country's working people, all the employed people, in terms of their existing productive skills and abilities. Only when your skills and abilities are identified, then you are hired, and due to that particular hiring, you are able to deliver your concept in the form of the products. Looking at the population from this productive aspect means you have to look to your population not as a liability. If India is the second world largest populated country, the population should be seen as an asset, not as a liability. So looking at the population from the productive aspect, if a country is so populous, what good can be, you know, taken out from them? How we can turn them to a good resource? That should be thought of, rather than ignoring them and only concentrating in the people who are really well educated, or only the sectors that are growing rich day by day. So if a country has to be developed, each and every person should be considered as a resource rather than a liability, as an asset rather than a liability. Looking at the population from this productive aspect emphasizes its ability, emphasizes, you know, putting stress to that particular point, emphasizes its ability to contribute to the creation of the gross national product. If you imagine, if we see the workers who work, for example, in the biscuit factory, the staffs, okay, only the ingredient maker, only that particular chef is going to do the mixing of the things, but the final product when it comes out, the packaging, to see everything is getting in the correct mode. When these people are hired, clear, they are seen as the human capital. But how we can put population into human capital in this scenario? Including and training the people who are not even versed with that particular machinery process, by putting faith of the people by putting faith into the people of your country that yes, my country men are smart and they will be able to achieve the training that has been provided. But most probably this kind of people are ignored, seeing their social status. So everybody's progress should be very important, and it must be very important for the altogether economic development of the country. That is the point which has to be explained over here. Only due to this, the creation of the gross national product will emerge. Like other resources, population is also a resource, a human resource. So population should not be seen in a negative way. Rather than that, we should use it as a resource. We should see it through our eyes, you know, positivity, where that liability structure goes, and modifying it into an asset. Clear, children? I hope you have understood this. Let us slide ahead. This is the positive side of a large population that is often overlooked when we look only at the negative side, considering only the problems of providing the population with food, education, and access to health facilities. So this particular point correlates to the point that we have just looked in the last slide. So you should look your population with a positive point of view. It is as simple as that. Put faith on your people. Your people will not let you down. Their interests should be identified. They should be given training according to their education, and only when they are self-dependent, the country can become independent. With lots of poor people or with lots of slums, no country is going to become a developed country. So seeing population as an asset gives dimensions, various dimensions, to not only the people but to the country as well. As people grow, the country grows. So rather than seeing them as liability and just as a responsibility, if we only focus to provide them with basic food, education and access to health facilities, that is, you know, not enough, because we are not, you know, helping them children to come out of that particular situation. For some time you can help them, but that is not going to help them in any other way, because you are not structuring them, you are just helping them. But instead of this, side by side, if you know, a basic training of any of the thing, say if a person is been given training how to operate the crane, clear, how he can work as a good labor, clear. So here you are inputting your knowledge, you are transforming your knowledge to the other person, where he is becoming self-dependent, where he is earning. You are not helping, but he is earning for himself, he is self-supporting himself. So this becomes the major difference over here. So population should not be seen as the liability, because not every now and then the government comes and stand with the people. It is not at all possible. But instead of that, if government focuses on making every individual self-dependent according to that particular factor, the person will grow along with the country. So this points have to be taken in a more positive manner. When the existing human resource is further developed by becoming more educated and healthy, we call it human capital formation. Human resource, the children who are getting well educated, clear? Till then you are a resource because your country is working upon you, clear? Sometime or someday you're going to pay back through becoming independent by creating, you know, financial strengthness, not only for yourself but for the country as also. So the human resource is further developed by becoming more educated and healthy. So that particular concept is called human capital formation. Capital formation, investment. Clear? If you are investing your knowledge, if you are training some person for something, you are investing your knowledge. So once he is employed, human capital formation has been done. So if you train 10 people, they automatically turn into human capital formation that adds to the productive power of the country, just like physical capital formation. Without cement, without iron, building is not possible, correct? But as vice versa, without human, a building cannot stand on its own as well. It is give and take relation. So instead of seeing people as liability, the population as liability, one has to trust on them, and they have to train them, make them self-reliable, so that the country develops simultaneously. Investment in human capital through education, training, medical care yields a return. We just now spoke about you being educated and you work for your country, you are yielding a return. Just like investment in physical capital, gold, we spoke about the physical capital. This can be seen directly in the form of higher incomes earned because of high productivity of the more educated or better trained persons as well as the higher productivity of healthier people. It is very well known, when you are well educated, you earn good. When you earn good, you get a good lifestyle, basic lifestyle. I'm not talking about the materialistic things, but a basic good lifestyle where you have ample of money, to go to the doctor at least if you're not well. Clear? So everybody is earning from one another. So while education plays a very vital role in shaping the people's lives, not only do the more educated and the healthier people gain through higher incomes, society also gains in other indirect ways, because the advantages of a more educated or a healthier population spreads to those also who themselves were not directly educated or given healthcare. So this, if a person is not been given opportunity to get educated, say due to any circumstances in life, and if he has been found of the substance that he is good in studies, only because of lack of money the person is held back for the basic education. Here the government must support that particular students or that particular children so that they contribute to the economic growth of our country. So when these all things have been seen by the unemployed people also, they see people are growing through education, right? When they see you doing so, they follow you. As an example, here they have given example of healthcare and of being hygiene. That particular importance of being hygienic is been passed on through the educated society. But people as population, everyone is equal children. So we should have that optimistic point of view of not treating anybody as a liability but as an asset. Let us slide ahead. In fact, human capital is in one way superior to other resources like land and physical capital. Human resource can make use of land and capital. Land and capital cannot become useful on its own, as we discussed in the earlier slides. For constructing a building, as the cement and iron rods are important, it cannot stand by itself, right? So it has to have a living being working upon it. So human resource is one step ahead than these physical resources. For many decades in India, a large population has been considered a liability rather than an asset. This is a very true. That is the reason we discussed in our previous slides that looking at your people should never be an liability. You should find opportunity in everything. As we all have learned from our school and through the situation that we have come from, we should see the challenges as an opportunity rather than seeing it as a problem or any critical situation that we are into. So in every complex situation, we have to find the positive side and we have to create an opportunity so that we can come out of that particular challenge. So our country's challenge is what? It is population. Now this particular concept, population, has to be treated with the term opportunity rather than liability. It should be considered as an asset. But a large population need not be a burden for the economy. It can be turned into a productive asset by investment in human capital. For example, by spending resources on education and health for all, training of industrial and agricultural workers in the use of modern technology, useful scientific researches, and so on. So what they are telling? But a large population need not be a burden for the economy. That's very simple and clear. So for this, what we have to do? The government should skin and scan the data according to the area wise. They have to see the amount of employed and unemployed persons, right? And the list where they find unemployment there, they can train them by giving them education, by making them understand the importance of health, giving them industrial training, and for the farmers, agricultural workers, how they will use the modern technology in their fields, and useful scientific researches. When this particular thing is being worked upon with the unemployed people, automatically they are going to get trained and they are going to turn as an asset for that country. Asset is the thing that is going to give you in something in return. Clear? So if you are investing in your people, the outcome is for both, for the individual as well and for the country as well. Clear, children? So nurturing human capital for economic growth is very, very important. Let us slide ahead. So the concepts which we learned in the earlier slides, children, let us see it in the form of a story. So there were two friends, Vilas and Sakal, with two different situations. Let us first read the story of Sakal. There were two friends, Vilas and Sakal, living in the same village, Semapur. Sakal was a 12-year-old boy. His mother Sheila looked after domestic chores. His father Bhuta Chaudhary worked in an agricultural field. Sakal helped his mother in domestic chores. He also looked after his younger brother Jitu and sister Situ. His uncle Shyam had passed the matriculation examination. Matriculation is standard 10th examination, but was sitting idle in the house as he did not have job. So you can see his uncle is a resource, but he did not turn into a human capital because he is not working. Bhuta and Sheila, that is Sakal's parents. Bhuta and Sheila were eager to teach Sakal. They forced him to join the village school, which he soon joined. He started studying and completed his higher secondary examination. His father persuaded him to continue his studies. He forced him to continue his studies. He raised a loan for Sakal to study a vocational course in computers. Sakal was meritorious and interested in studies. He was so interested that he used to come first in class. And interested in studies from the beginning. With great vigor and enthusiasm, he completed his course. After some time, he got a job in a private organization. He even designed a new kind of software. This software helped him increase the sale of the firm. His boss acknowledged his services and rewarded him with a promotion. So here in this story, you see the parents of Sakal, clear, that is Bhuta and Sheila, they saw their son as an asset rather than liability. So when he went to school, he studied very well, then he completed his 12th standard, then his father, he raised a loan for the vocational course in computers. Even there, he came out with the flying colors and after some time he was hired by a private organization. In that organization, his skills, we spoke about the skill and the product, right? So his skills were analyzed. He designed a new kind of software. His skill is his brain, his knowledge, and the software is the product. This software helped him increase the sale of the firm. So you're understanding, the product which was been created by him was useful to the firm in such a manner that the boss acknowledged, he was appreciated for his services and rewarded and gave him a promotion. So here the promotion is not only for Sakal, it is for the company as well, and through the company the country is also benefiting. So here three people are growing. Can see Sakal along with his higher officer, the company, and along with them the country. So this is called the process, human capital process. See your population as an asset rather than a liability. Let us slide ahead to see the story of Sakal's friend Vilas. Story of Vilas. Vilas was an 11-year-old boy residing, that is staying, in the same village as Sakal. Vilas' father Mahesh was a fisherman. His father passed away when he was only 2 years old. When Vilas was 2 years old, his father Mahesh passed away and he was a fisherman. His mother Geeta sold fish to earn money to feed the family. She bought fish from the landowner's pond and sold it in the nearby mandi, that is market. She could earn only rupees 150 a day by selling fish. Later, Vilas became a patient of arthritis. His mother could not afford to take him to doctor. He could not go to school either. He was not interested in studies. He helped his mother in cooking and also looked after his younger brother Mohan. After some time, his mother fell sick and there was no one to look after her. There was no one in the family to support them. Vilas too was forced to sell fish in the same village. He, like his mother, earned only a meager income. Meager is mediocre income, limited income. So through this story, we can understand that Vilas's father, he passed away when he was 2 years old. To fight the poverty, his mother Geeta, she sold fish in the market. But at the same time, she did not take effort to send Vilas to school. And due to this, Vilas also lost his studies. Going ahead, his mother too became sick and nobody was there to support their family because Vilas's education was been, you know, interrupted due to his father's death and mother was selling the fish. So due to these reasons, even Vilas did not create an opportunity for himself. He was comfortable in the atmosphere, in the zone he was living. Correct. So there is no formation of new skill and no concept of the person being seen as an asset. Clear? So due to this, even Vilas ended up selling fish like his mother and he earned only a mediocre income. So these two examples are very well versed with the concept we dealt with. Let us slide ahead. In the two case studies, we saw Sakal went to school and Vilas did not go. Sakal was physically strong and healthy. there was no need for him to visit the doctor frequently. Vilas was a patient of arthritis. He lacked the means to visit the doctor. Sakal acquired a degree in computer programming. Sakal found a job in private firm while Vilas continued with the same work as his mother. He earned a meager income like his mother to support a family. This is the summary of both the stories given. In the case of Sakal, several years of education added to the quality of labor. Your investment, education was the investment, and the quality of the work was the outcome that will shape the product on which Sakal worked. This enhanced his total productivity. Enhanced is showing him up. This enhanced his total productivity. Total productivity adds to the growth of the economy. As I told you, four people are growing. Sakal, his manager, along with them, the organization, and through organization, the country. This in turn pays an individual through salary or in some other form of his choice. In case of Vilas, there could not be any education or health care in the early part of his life. He spends his life selling fish like his mother. Henceforth, he draws the same salary of unskilled laborer as his mother. Why? Because the government did not see them as the asset, but they saw them only as the liability. And not only the government, we ourselves should must have self-confidence in ourselves by shaping the thoughts, by giving the thoughts the structure, and we have to work on ourselves too by making us self-employed. If we do not want to be employed by someone, we will be beneficial to the country, but through self-employment, creating employment by ourselves. Clear, but some or the other way the country has to grow. Let us slide ahead. Investment in human resource via education and medical care can give high rates of return in future. This investment on people is the same as investment in land and capital. It is very true, when you invest in people, they are going to pay you back as they are employed, and the country goes up through their employment. Clear? So as land and capital, why I have given the example, once you purchase the land, of course the land's value keeps on increasing day by day. So that is the reason. Your education is also your asset. A child too with investments made on her education and health can yield a high return in future in the form of higher earnings and greater contribution to the society as well. You're setting an example. Clear? So along with your earnings, you're setting an example plus giving the your own inspiration so that people can follow your steps. Educated parents are found to invest more heavily on the education of their child. This is because they have realized the importance of education for themselves. Heavily investment on education, it happens only while you complete your master's or your bachelor's degree, because that is the time in which field we are going to enter, that has been decided after your 11th and 12th. In 11th and 12th, we have the commerce, science and arts sections. Through that, you create your path ahead. They are also conscious of proper nutrition and hygiene. They accordingly look after their children's needs for education at school and good health. A virtuous cycle is thus created in this case, virtuous cycle, which is a positive way, which is seen as an opportunity. Now we have different kinds of boards in schools, children. So according to the financial structure of the family, parents do put their children into the school. Here the virtuous cycle is the positive cycle. Let us go ahead and see what the vicious cycle has to offer us. In contrast, that is in opposite to the virtuous cycle, a vicious cycle may be created by disadvantaged parents who themselves, uneducated and lacking in hygiene, keep their children in a similarly disadvantaged state. This oftenly we see in slum areas, children. Countries like Japan have invested in human resource. They believe in each and every citizen of their country, and their major asset, if we ask any country, what is their major asset? They will tell their citizens. They look after their citizens in such a good way that they set examples for the other countries to follow. They did not have any natural resource. These countries are developed and rich. They import the natural resource needed in their country. They imported. How did they become rich or developed? They have invested on people, especially in the field of education and health. So even the poorest child in that country is taken into consideration, is been helped, and he or she is been educated. The child has not been neglected. These people have made efficient use of other resources like land and capital. Efficiency and the technology evolved by people has made these countries rich and developed. Efficiency and the technology evolved. Efficiency is what making each and every child to get education. We are making that child into a more efficient manner. Plus the technology. New technology, the studying of new technology, evolved by people, evolved is changed by people, has made these countries rich and developed. Clear? So we just saw the example of the disadvantaged children living in slum areas. It is due to poverty, children, only due to poverty. Once this, if government decides to work on this factor, poverty will diminish in lesser time. So the poor people should not be seen as liability, rather they have to be seen as an asset that will lessen down the crime rates as well, like robbery, theft, any criminal activities. If a person is employed, obviously he is not going to go into such kind of field. So by creating opportunities, by seeing them as an asset, 80% of the country's problem is solved over there. So the entire lesson, the part of the lesson gives us the idea about how human as a resource, when he is been treated as an asset, can give you positive outcomes, not only now but forever for the country until he is dead. Clear? So I hope you have understood this particular section of the lesson, children. Let us go ahead. Thank you for joining me in this session, children. I hope you have understood the concept in a very clear and peculiar manner. We will see the ahead aspects in our coming lecture. Until then, stay safe, stay fit. Thank you.